All right, Dennis, thank you for today. Thank you for your time today. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you for your time.
Good. Thank you for partaking in these 10 interviews. I've said in a couple of them already the importance of sharing a bit about the work that the individuals within the community are doing. And I've said that we're really good at discussing topics and having conversations, but they're not necessarily knowing exactly the type of person people we're discussing these comments with and the backgrounds of the people we're discussing these things with. And I think actually when you get that context and you get that perspective of all the different types of people within the community and all the different backgrounds and all the different kind of missions and purposes, I think it's really, really even more powerful. So sharing your story is really, really important, a really important part of that. So thank you. I know you have a fascinating background, and obviously, I don't know if everyone can tell, but from your background, literally behind you, you're in Australia, Perth. You're from
Yes.
Perth, Australia. And you kind of obviously from there, but you've got a wider background as well, and you've been there for a while,
Yes.
but doing some interesting work. So I'd love it if you could just tell us a bit about your background, and how you got started.
Okay. Well, I grew up in a, quite a economically downtrodden place, I suppose. Eastern Canada was never very strong economically, and I always knew that there was more to life than just getting up and going to work and watching television. And I worked really hard on, I guess, just building things. And then I've always had a bit of an entrepreneurial spirit right from the age of 12 or 13 years of age. I'd mow lawns. I always had a job. I always managed to find work, even though I didn't really enjoy the work that I did, but I did what I had to do to do what I had to do. And a lot of my mates always complained, and nothing was. So I never really complained. I always just got on with things. And I've always had that kind of attitude where I always knew that life was special and the journey was. I always knew I had something. I thought differently. At the year 12, I think I asked for Bob Dylan's greatest hits, and my mom didn't know what the hell was going on with me at the time. And so it was always, I guess, a bit unique in the way I thought and the way I behaved. And I've always believed, I guess I believed in myself, but I've always knew that, I don't know, I always knew it was going to be okay. I always knew that life was going to look after me, but I always worked really hard towards that. And, and I was always an alternative thinking individual, but I always kind of thought, more as an entrepreneur, because working was part of my. It was my P&L, my day, my week. I'd sacrifice a certain amount of hours to make a certain amount of money so I could, buy beer and fuel for my car and all the things that I did, I guess. And
Yeah, great.
then I, as we do, and then I, and as I got a bit older, I guess I, I've always had a really strong work ethic, and that's really pushed me through. And I lived in a little town where everybody just knew everyone, and it was a lovely little place. And there was one stage in my life where, I had an opportunity to leave, and I didn't. I stayed behind for a certain girl, and I really regretted that. All my mates moved to the mountains. And they had a lot of fun, and I kind of squandered, I guess, that opportunity. Then another opportunity came where someone had a free return ticket home, and I just jumped on the plane and walked to the mountains, and I. Just that was it. That was me, and I was quite old by that stage. I was 25, so this was 1990. And I arrived on New Year's Eve at 11:45, and all my mates met me at the airport at the train station, and that was us. Just then I moved to the mountains. I let go of everything. I just kind of completely cut myself off of society. I didn't, first thing, I didn't watch television for 5 years. I didn't read newspapers. I just stayed completely. This is before internet. And this is 1991, 92, 93, 94. And then I met this girl who ended up following her home, I guess, and ended up in Australia. So
Great.
I really, I've always found the positive in most situations throughout all my journey, I guess.
Do you think that you're connected, that's connected to your drive, I guess? So your drive to. Often, I think people see drive simply as a motivation to earn money or to be successful. Whereas, often, that's from your perspective, from what I understand about you, is that your drive is connected with having a positive life. And actually, you just want to be in a good position where you're happy and fulfilled. Do you think?
More so than money. I was never really driven by money.
Yeah,
It was
exactly.
more just experience. You can, as much as you can. And that was always my thing.
Yeah.
Savor it and really taste it.
Yeah, yeah. Fantastic.
You know, yeah. Suck it to the bone, I guess.
Nice. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And so then obviously Australia, kind of that savouring the experience, like completely, like just following a girl home back to Australia. What happened there? What happened then?
Well, I came over in 93, 94 to see if I could live here. So I didn't come here I came on a work holiday visa. I was park ranger in the Rockies, so I had a 6 month secondment to the government. So I had a seasonal position, and I thought I'll just come here for the Aussie summer. And I didn't come here to holiday like everyone else did. I came here to see what I wanted to experience a day in the life in Australia.
Yeah.
See what it was like to live here. And, you know, we were obviously quite fond of each other at the time. And then I came and I was quite negative. You know, I was comparing everything to home because I didn't want to leave home. I had all my mates, my tribe, everyone was there. And I was really quite, you know, very well connected. And, you know, I got a lot of really good mates. And so I didn't want to leave that behind. But when I came here, couldn't wait to go home. And then as soon as I got back home, nothing changed. I thought, what am I doing? So we came back in 95, and it was an opportunity for me to reinvent myself, I suppose, because I had no past. I had no, it was just kind of a clear slate. And I took that as a real positive. And I met someone in 93, 94. We started playing music together. And right away on day two, we were jamming and setting up songs, and you know, within a year our band was playing on a regular basis, and it was really easy for me to perform because I had no past in this country. Yeah. So I had I guess it was an opportunity for me to, I guess, reinvent myself, but also to get rid of the things maybe I didn't like about my personality, or you know, it's kind of like it's really quite interesting, you know. And I struggled a lot because I was always surrounded by people back at home, but all of a sudden I spent a lot of time alone, which is what I really needed to do, and it's great. So yeah.
Yeah, nice. And do you think the because thinking about the stuff you then later went on to, that ability to, in essence, start afresh, which I think is really a really powerful thing, and obviously not everybody gets the opportunity to do, but actually. Not in terms of the literal sense of physically moving yourself from one location to another location where you have no past and you have nothing to deal with. That actually, that ability from one day to the next, change your situation and change the direction of your life and focus on what's important and cut out, in essence, because from you moving to Canada to Australia, you almost got rid of a lot of the noise and a lot of the stuff that, like, obviously your mates are really important and all the stuff, but it's almost like the history of the place and the stuff you have there is kind of holding you back a little bit from actually what you want to be doing.
And it's people's expectations and most more than anything, you know, and that's, I had no expectations. I had no, you know, Sarah's family who I've just met.
Yeah.
You know, so it was phenomenal. You know, looking back, and I found one of my journals the other day, and I was cleaning the garage, and I went back to it and I started reading it the other night, and it's really amazing. Like every day I'm just, it was like a new birth for me. It was really, really, you know, and I took full advantage of that. You know, I accepted pretty much the fact that I was leaving a lot of people behind. I was leaving a lot of memories and things behind. And to start afresh, that did. And I spent a lot of time alone for the first time in my life. And I really, really relished in that. Because a lot of people see me and they think I'm quite an extroverted person, but I am quite of an introvert, really, and deep down.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think you and I share that nature often. I'm an extrovert when I need to be, and therefore I'm therefore because that's the side that people see most, because it's the external side, then they assume that that's just the way I am. But actually, I enjoy solitude. And I know the first time we spoke, I was living on an island. I chosen to live on an island and get away from everybody and everything to seek solitude, but still my friends thought I was an extrovert, so it was very hard for them to kind of understand that solitude. And it's really important, actually. So you got into music, you fell in love with music and you started playing, and then where did that lead you? Like,
well, I was always involved in music from the age of 17, 18 years of age. As soon as I picked up a guitar, I was, within a year and a half, I was playing in bands, so... and when I left my hometown and went to the Rockies, my band had kind of fallen apart, my previous band. So then I got here, and then we started playing heaps. And then, you know, by 1998, we won Best Original Rock Song in West Australia. We were playing lots of gigs. We were identified by lots of bands. And, you know, it was going really, really well. I was working in a rock climbing shop, which is great. And, you know, I was big, very passionate climber at the time. And then around this time, I think it was 97, yeah, so 20 years ago this time, I got involved in rope access. So someone asked me if I wanted to wash some windows on a skyscraper. Yeah. I was like, yeah, absolutely, you know, and I had to learn how to wash windows. That was the hardest part of working 40 stories up. And then I, you know, so I kept that going. So then I worked in an outdoor shop. I played music. I washed windows and put up advertising banners and worked on, you know, high-rise buildings and things. So I always had something quite interesting going on. And I met a whole – and I didn't want to be reliant on my wife's friends. So it was really important for me to make my own, I guess, connections. And through music and the climbing industry, I met a wonderful circle of people. And, nice. Which to this day are still some of my closest friends. So
yeah, great. And I know the rope access stuff then led you into kind of what it is you were doing following that, and kind of the business you started, and how you developed that business, I think, which we'll talk more about, seems to me to be related to all those experiences you had and you seeking a good environment and a good atmosphere and also a happy place. So from the rope access stuff, from getting into cleaning skyscrapers, what kind of sparked that moment where you started your company?
My wife felt pregnant, so
I had
to get a real job.
It's great motivation.
it was an incredible motivator because I was recording on a second album at the time, and we're just on the verge of, you know, some really interesting things. You know, we're the first band in Perth to be sponsored by, you know, a beer company. We had sunglass sponsorship. We had clothing sponsorship. So we're really kind of heading in a really interesting place. And then my wife found out she's pregnant after 8 years of marriage. And I, you know, asked how that would happen, but I knew how it happened. But we didn't really plan on having children. But I, you know, the minute my daughter was put in my hands, I immediately realized that it wasn't about me anymore. And that was the motivator that got me heavily into rope access. So I really started a career working away from home. So I spent between 6 to 8 months away for the first probably 6 years, 8 years of my daughter's life.
Okay.
So I'm just working on oil rigs all over the world. So I've worked all through Asia, extensively through Asia and all through Australia and up to the Middle East. And I did some really amazing jobs, some really shit jobs, you know, but it made me realize it's all about the people that you're with. And no matter where you are, what you're doing, you surround yourself with good people. You know, we could be shoveling shit for a whole week, and you know, you throw a little bit on my foot, and I throw a bit on your foot, and start having a bit of a laugh, you know. And it's that whole psychology of finding that middle ground where you know, you've got to stay positive. Otherwise, you're no good to anyone, you know.
No, completely, absolutely agree. And no matter what situation you're in, then you have to find the positivity in it. Yeah, completely. And actually, that's where I believe your drive comes from, actually finding the positivity in the scenario and making the best of it and finding the success from that positivity, which is great, which is I find very inspiring, and hopefully lots of other people will. And so you were doing that, and then I know you then went into your own company and actually embedded those principles and that philosophy within the way you ran the company, which I think I find fascinating, having struggled with those experiences myself when I'm an employee, to that ethos that you took into the company you work for. So can you tell us a bit more about the structure and the well-being stuff that you had?
For us, we started, you know, the work that we did was very industrialized. You know, we worked on oil rigs and ships, and you know, they're big companies, are the Chevrons and the Exxons, and here in Australia, it's the Woodsides. You know, they're very, very big organizations. And for us, it was really about the people. You know, so when we set up Vertec, you know, the first value was with people, their health and their happiness, and clients and suppliers. Everyone we dealt with was treated with respect, dignity, and honesty. And that was really important for us. And open, honest conversations were had, and really it was about inspiring and empowering our people, and keeping them safe, and also, you know, being innovative. And so we had a lot of other things that we worked really hard towards, but it was what made our companies successful. It was believing in our people and really giving them a sense of belonging, which is something I long for. We discussed thoroughly the last time, you know, and giving people a sense of it's kind of a validation of their purpose.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think it's really funny that, because society, technically, if you consider it, is just a fabrication that we create as people to organize ourselves, right? And companies are just a result of that. And actually, when you come down to it, it's all still about people. No matter what you're doing, or no matter how big you are, or no matter what you're doing, it's all about people. And the results of that, so money and kind of the size of your company and the work you get in, is just purely a result of all that stuff. And people often forget that. So actually, your focus on people, I think, is a really key thing that hopefully the 10 Network already understand this, but actually anyone else who watches this video sees that kind of you achieved success by looking after people,
like the Richard Branson model. I read Losing My Virginity back in 2001, and had a big impact on me. And I really loved the whole, you know, look after your staff will look after your clients. And because my day, when I went to college, you know, the three rules of business were your customer is always right, second rule was customer is always right, and the third rule, when in doubt, go to rule number one. And that was a bit of very Americanized, I guess, philosophy, where Richard Branson just went, nah, mate, you know, look after your people, and they'll look after your business. And not only that, they look after their clients, they protect the industry, they protect their business. And someone is showing bad behaviors, often they'll bring that to light. Because it matters to them, you know. And for us, it was really, that was the most powerful thing. And it was a really special time in all our lives, I guess.
It's powerful. It's a really important message. Really, really important message. And anything, any companies that hopefully spin off and come out of 10, and anyone who's doing anything in 10 will take that away. And actually, as soon as they start... Yeah, it's all about people, completely.
The return on investment is huge, you know, and I've always had a philosophy that the byproduct of love is cash. But when you start making all your decisions based on money, then you lose the love, and then you lose a lot of, of the special things, you know?
Yeah, happiness doesn't come after cash. Cash comes after happiness.
And it's really, honestly, it's just the little things that mean more than all those things, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Completely agree. And employee well-being is essential, and I think that's probably the key message from the early stuff you're doing and with Vertec. But what are you doing now? What? Because I know we talked about what brought you to 10, and I think it's really fascinating and what you're doing now.
I'm on a quest for purpose. So for me, it's been I sold the company. I resigned in February 2015. So I've had effectively a year and a bit off, and almost a year and a half off, and spent a lot of time in here. Which is quite challenging for me. You know, you work all your life to get a certain place, and you know, you think, you know, you've got money, this and that. It becomes easy, but if anything, it's probably the most challenging year I've had. I found myself really quite questioning things and seeking that happiness again. And you know, I've always liked the fight and you know, the uncertainty of what's next, and all of a sudden things got comfortable, and in that. In that period, I really started seeking, you know, that purpose again, and what's the drive, and what's important. And so I got involved in quite a few things. You know, I started recording music again, which is
great,
which is really powerful for me. And I, you know, I think at the very end of Vertec, my daughter got quite ill, and she had this bone infection. It was a few days where we didn't know what was going on, and then, you know, she was fine in the end. But there was a period of during that week where I was sitting down, I was writing an email to my staff, and I saw my daughter's name on the screen, and I kind of broke down. And my son was having a shower, and I was trying to be brave for this whole period. And once we knew she was okay, but even before that, I'd give anything, everything I had, I would just give it all away, just for someone to tell me that she was going to be okay. And during that period, I found that that's when I started really questioning, like, what's it all about? What does it all mean? All this. And the business got so big at that stage. We had that many people. It started losing what it had when we first started it, you know, because it got so big. It was hard to manage. And my business partners had already left at this point. So they left early into the three-year thing. So they left within the first year, I believe. And so I saw my term through. And then I just resigned – over dinner without really having a plan, and that caught me off guard. You know, it made me realize during this time off and that you need something, you need purpose, you need to be involved. You know, sitting around and just being alone and just waiting for something to fall on your lap.
Yeah,
it just doesn't happen that way. So that's where I found. I went to a talk, and it's funny because I'd just been hanging out with a mate of mine. He said, "Oh, we'll go get this talk in the city," and I really didn't want to go. I said, "Oh." It was a nice cold night. I had a fire in the fireplace, but I got up and went out, and Jonathan was there, and I was really inspired by one of his. You know, there was one point where he talked about where he was waiting for the manager of Microsoft, who was doing the real the video. What was it? He spent 2 days waiting to try to pitch him on how to reduce file sizes on the media player, as it was, and that just blew me away. And I said, "Wow, this guy's got balls." You know, he just takes that, and I love that. You know, and I was very, very inspired by Jonathan's. By his talk and just by his energy and the way he thought. And I was really, I was quite fascinated. So I had to learn more. So I
signed up. And you're a bit of a waterman.
I was a mountain tree kind of guy and a bit of a tree hugger and mountain fanatic. And I got heavily into climbing and everything. And then I moved to the mountain, moved to the ocean and to Australia. And I, absolutely, and I saw Jonathan's.
That's what I was about to say. You saw his turtle,
And I've been wanting to get. I just had my 50th, and I've always said I was going to get a turtle tattoo. And so I'm fascinated by the ocean, and I love holding my breath as long as I possibly can, and just going down and exploring. And it's a new world. And just what I love the most probably is just the quiet.
Interestingly, I'd say that's a great. That's a great physical manifestation of going inside your head, actually.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. It's but being distracted at the same time.
Yeah. There's all this stuff going on, but there's a lot of calm, and actually you've got to hold your breath and see what comes up, right? Yeah.
Exactly. And then sometimes a few times where I caught myself gone down a bit deeper than I had anticipated. And you're coming up, you're kind of, and it's that physical mental challenge where.
Yeah.
But the more I do it, the more relaxed you become, the longer your breath holds are. And it's just, I'm fascinated by the ocean. I'm absolutely fascinated.
Yeah, same. And again, something we share. So my background, a bit more kind of like marine archaeology and diving. So actually, being underwater for long periods of time, I do directly relate that to meditation and mindfulness. And actually, and it's a fantastic metaphor for that process of going down. And the longer you do it, and the more you stay down, the more calm it gets, and the more peaceful you get, and the longer you can do it for, and the more value you get from it. And that's kind of
that's effectively how I learned to meditate. It's through freediving. It's like you say, because I'm not a very meditative person. I'm quite a pretty ADHD type of kind of guy. Yeah. So for me, the water allowed me to really focus on breath. And to realize how important breath is, as
you're
saying.
So. Yeah. Well, it comes in all forms, and often people mistake meditation for sitting down and closing your eyes and trying to shut yourself up for 10 minutes. But it's so much more than that. So you mentioned earlier, kind of like, for you, it's all about life has meaning and purpose. So what's the meaning and what's the purpose at the moment? What's now?
I'm really, really passionate about people. I've always been very passionate about people. I really care. I'm an empath. I feel. I got a sixth sense. I can feel things before seeing it, type thing. So I think my purpose now is really to assist and to be there to support and to mentor, and at the same time to learn from myself. Like I learn a lot by working with other people, and so I've set up a little called the Leadership Den. So I'm doing a lot of setting up leadership programs and sales programs and just things. It's really taking people on a journey. I was really inspired by the Unlock session and the whole reverse engineering of a concept and how do you. My initial plan was to do this, but I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know how to go about it, how to create a training program on leadership, especially leadership, because it's very clunky. But now, I'm trying to think differently now. So I reverse engineer my own. what you know, I think about the outcome, and then I, how do we get there? And I can plan these things out a lot clearer now. So
great.
So I'm getting, yeah, getting a few clients now, and
nice.
I'm out there, and you know, trying to get work effectively. Yeah.
Nice. Can you give us just a few kind of insights or nuggets on leadership and how we might be better leaders?
I'm just trying to change the way people think about leadership. You know, I'm trying to challenge the way people, you know, there's management and there's leadership. And for me, you know, it's really simple. It's like we did with Vertec. You give people a sense of belonging. You care. You ask questions. And be very genuine. Ask questions. And when you say thank you, mean it. Mm-hmm. But the same token, involve people. You know, we're stronger together. You know, the whole thing of working with others is getting them involved and ask them questions. You know, they may, you know, I may not, you know, I'm going to ask you a question. You know, I may already have an idea. I may know already what we want to do, what we have to do, but I'll involve you anyway. And for me, it's taking people on the journey. It's as simple as that.
Yeah.
But it's so hard for people to do because everyone wants to control everything. And that's where it goes astray.
Yeah. I think people, especially when people get into leadership positions, they struggle with not giving the answer, when actually what leadership often about is allowing asking the question to inspire the person to find the answer themselves. And that's really powerful. And that's actually a lot of the stuff that I got from Jonathan, was him simply asking me questions and finding the answers for myself. And I think,
but that's the perfect form of, you know, I had a college teacher who I saw on Facebook today was retiring. And I did a 1-year sales course with this guy. And it was, you know, I'd ask him a question, you know, like, well, do you know the answer to this? And he said, yes, he'd walk away. And it was that form of coaching and effectively turning that, becoming a coach, becoming the person to inspire others. And every, you know, sometimes you have to make some really difficult decisions, and you have to, you know, as a leader, sometimes you have to do the right thing for the organization. But, you know, you bring people on a journey and you inspire others to achieve greatness, and everybody wins.
Completely. And I think the fantastic thing about 10 is, and one, as I said before, the reasons for these videos is actually the wealth of experience and knowledge within 10 as a community and the people within it, because we're talking about people, the actual people within it is so valuable, but actually, and the knowledge and experience of those people is so valuable, and also their ability to ask the questions. I think we ask a lot of questions around subjects and topics, but actually, as you say, like us just asking a question of each other then sparks some really, really interesting thinking. So being able to share your view on all that stuff is really valuable. And I hope that from this, a lot of people kind of start asking more questions about each other and perspectives and the experience, and actually people start getting to know the community. I think the drinks are really fantastic, but actually people starting to get to know the community and the people that they're having debates with and discussing different ideas with. I think it's really important.
I think a big part of it, just to add on to that, is asking a question, but listening. Ask a question and then already think of your response of where we're going. You know, because a lot of people, you know, they'll ask a question, but they're already, you could see it. You could see their thinking. They're not really paying attention. And listening, it took me a long time to become a good listener. And I think that's something that's huge.
Yeah, I guarantee a lot of people, not necessarily in 10, but I think in the wider world, ask questions to be seen to be smart and asking a question as opposed to being caring about what the answer is. And that's a big challenge to overcome.
I don't do that because I'm not that smart.
I'm not going to comment on how smart you are. I think to be honest, you've done a lot of successful stuff. So and you found a good place for yourself, and that's pretty smart.
99% attitude and 1% aptitude. I read the
I like that. Yeah, great. And so you got into this space of thinking about contemplating yourself, right? Because you had a lot of headspace and you had a lot of time, and you went to the unlock sessions, and now you're in the leadership den. How are you going to? Yeah, go.
I just finished this as well, so that's my. I'll plug the album.
Nice, Supermoon Den.
this also came as a result of the unlock. You know, there's a song that I had, the 10th song, which I couldn't finish, and I started writing it 27 years ago. It's true proper writer's block, and I went on the second evening of my 10 sessions. I went to my room after a few glasses of wine, and I finished. I finally found the course on the final song. So I hold Jonathan and Miriam
responsible. But yeah, now you could have to give them commission. You shouldn't have said that.
I know.
Nice.
It's through music again, and through passion of people, and you know, it's following my dreams. And now my kids are at an age where they're almost self-sufficient. You know, I can start living life again. You know, as a father, you know, as you'll soon find out, you know, it's a challenging thing, because all of a sudden it's not about you anymore, and you realize it is about them. And the more you give them, the better people they become. But again, you can't lose yourself.
No.
Same thing with leadership. You know, you still have to be true to who you are. And
yeah.
I think it's important. A lot of people lose that, you know, when they start businesses, and they blame that, and they blame circumstances because of their unhappiness. And, you know, we are responsible for that.
Completely. And so a bit like your song, that took 27 years to write, you've been on quite a journey. And obviously throughout that journey, I think, because everything is, as you said, life is about meaning and the purpose that you have. I had a really interesting conversation with Miriam, actually, where she basically said that actually people are caught up on this idea of having a purpose, but actually don't realize that the purpose changes as you change and as you grow. And often people often seek this purpose as almost this, as this constant, like light. Or that is leading them towards something.
That's never found, because you sit down, it changes. It changes as you do, and the world changes around us. You know, and that's where people get. You need to move. You need to be dynamic. You need to move with that. And for me, when I say, you know, searching for purpose, I was just searching for something, because I've been so heavily involved in this organization for so long, and I gave so much of my life to it. And all of a sudden, I was on my own, and I found myself quite a challenge during that time, because I was seeking something. I was just expecting something to fall on my lap, but it was me get out and dust yourself off and make things happen.
Absolutely. And I think we have to grow, and I think all the best people, but the people who I find the happiest have that growth mindset and are always looking to evolve and get new information and change the way they think and improve. And it's all about experimentation, and therefore if you're doing that, then your purpose is going to change, and your purpose is going to evolve as you evolve, because your understanding of that purpose and understanding what you want to do changes. So you may not, like as you say, it may not necessarily have been what you considered your purpose at the time, but it was the right purpose. Whatever you found at the time was the right purpose to lead you down to the next thing.
That's where it builds to where you are now. You know,
it's a
journey of 1,000 steps starts with one step. You
know,
journey 1,000 miles starts with one step.
Journey of 1,000.
It is the journey. You know, effectively, that's what it is. It's effectively that. Most of my album is focused on the journey. You know, I talk a lot about the journey, and there's a lot of life that I put into this. And it's it is reminding. You know, and if nothing else, this is, you know, my son sitting down having a beer with his mate 10, 15 years from now, and he listens to some of the lyrics of these songs. You know, it is about that journey, and we often forget that. People get so caught up on. They get entitled, you know, and going back to the leadership thing, with people with a certain title, they feel a sense of entitlement, and I think we're responsible for our own doings and where we're at, and if we choose to be a victim, then we choose to be a victim, you know, and that's move on.
Yeah, completely.
Make it happen.
Yes, 100%. And so how are you continuing to grow from here now the album's done and you're doing this leadership then? Like, what kind of what source of inspiration and information do you seek out now to continue growing? Obviously, you've done the unlock session, but where is that driving you towards? And
it's brought me to a place where, you know, I've written a plan. I've gotten pretty much as far as I can. The album was great. The creation side of it was fantastic. Yeah. Now I've got to, you know, spearhead the business side of it, which is something that I'm not really all that keen to do, but I need to do it. I got to promote it. And that's part of my journey.
Yeah.
It's just getting off my ass. You know, we're coming to Christmas time. Everything's kind of heading to the new year. You know, I think a lot of people are happy to see 2016 just pass us by, and there's a lot of hope, you know, for 2017 and 2018 and what have you. And I've always had hope for today, and I try to live as much into the now as I possibly can. So really, effectively for me, it's just to keep the growth, you know, keep being there for my kids and eat well, size, try to stay positive and just take it as it comes. You know, the leadership den might be a stepping stone. Is that where I'm going to be in 10 years? I've got no idea, but I'm not locking myself in anything. You know, I just want to enjoy the journey as much as I possibly can.
Fantastic.
But challenge myself, you know.
Nice. And can you make any recommendations, like just a few things that you think have helped you along your journey in terms of books? Or you mentioned that you obviously read Richard Branson's book earlier, but are there any things that you think people have to read and that might help them like continue on their journey?
So many amazing books out there, you know.
I know. So it's a tough question.
Oh, it's a tough one. It is. Someone told me last night, you know, someone highly recommended Conversations with God, you know, which I was uploading it today. So that's something I've got to read. But I read a lot of, The Alchemist is a great little book. Every once in a while, I'll just read that again, just to remind me about the journey again and where it's all here. So many, you know, Eckhart Tolle, The Power of Now. You know, that book really helped me through my period, you know, of challenge. You know, there's a section of talking, you know, watching the thinker, and I refer to that all the time now. If I see myself just kind of wallowing, or it's like, hey, I'll get back on track.
Yeah.
New Earth. There's so many amazing books.
The Alchemist and Power of Now are two great recommendations, and hopefully, I know both of those had a huge impact on me. So hopefully, if people haven't read them, they'll seek them out. Great. Wow. Dennis, thank you for sharing your story. Thank you for sharing your journey. It's really good to talk to you.
No, I'm really grateful that I found that time to spend with Jonathan and Miriam and the other candidates on my course. You know, it was something that was really powerful. I really took a lot out of it, and I think anyone, you know, in the 10 community, you know, we've all been, I guess, subjected to something really quite special, and it's really, so much praise for those individuals. I done
absolutely. I think your testament to this, and actually my belief of the 10 network, is yes, Jonathan and Miriam completely. They are these inspirational and also challenging figures that help us think differently about certain things and give us new perspective, which is fantastic. But I believe that what they've created in the 10 network is a group of people who can do that for each other. And the unlock sessions are really powerful. And I've been to the U Day, and I've been to a lot of different sessions with the guys. But even talking to you and other conversations I've had with individuals, I know how much power and brilliance and also heart there is within the 10 community, and all these people who have different backgrounds and have different things to offer. And I'm a big believer in, and it all goes back to people, that actually when we compete with each other, we aren't successful, and actually we don't evolve. But actually when we collaborate is when it's how we evolve. It's literally how we evolved and how we evolve and how we continue to evolve and how we grow. So hopefully, and I think it's important, and I know I will be doing, and hopefully from these videos, people will almost be inspired to reach out to more people within 10 and use 10 as not just a resource for thinking and interesting questions and interesting articles, but a resource for brilliant people. And I think that's it's a great thing. And obviously I'm not suggesting everybody just starts calling each other, but just realize the power of the group that is being built, and appreciates. And everyone, I'm talking about every member. I think every member will have something to offer. So hopefully people will do that. Yeah, hopefully people do that. And I think your story about people and well-being and focusing on people is a testament to that. And when we all start kind of collaborating and talking and asking each other questions and then listening, we get a lot of value from it, which is great. And I think as long as people listen to the answers that are given on their questions and listen to the answers that are given on other people's questions and reading through them, there's a huge amount of wealth, and your testament to that. So thank you for your time. It's been really interesting. It's been great getting to know you in all of our conversations and sharing. And yeah, thanks. You're a true inspiration, and hopefully, if anyone's interested in the Leadership Den stuff, they'll reach out, and especially if they're in Australia. And I hope all goes well with everything.
Well, thank you, and good luck with fatherhood, mate. It's the best journey on earth, mate.
Thanks.
You're gonna love it.
Yeah,
you're gonna make a great day.
It's not about me anymore, so it's great. It's all good.
It's about you now, but
yeah, no.
However long it is, it won't be about you anymore, mate.
No. Interestingly, do you know what, I actually see it not being about me as being about me, because the ability to let go of everything, all the constructs that I had about myself that then create fear and all that stuff, and let go of all that and it just being about my child is actually a really good thing for me. And actually I'm gaining so much value from that. So actually it not being about me is also about me, and kind of just like this cyclical.
So look, because you have to be good, you know, you still have to be, you know, in a good headspace.
Yeah. And it's fantastic. So it's really, really good. Yeah. Awesome.
And continue being.
Yes, exactly. Being. Chat.
Thank you.
I hope everyone gets value from it. Great talking to you.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, mate. I didn't know we were going to film today, so I've just been in the pool. I've been loving it.
It's good. I prefer that. It's great. It's good.